Yes, a good question. Very good question. This question is, where did you call it? Where is heat? I mean, there's no heat here, right? The answer is yes. But it has traits as a default in it, which takes all traits that you pass. For example, I did all this. Who is setting this up? Sorry? Init of the ODE solver. There's no ODE solver in it. It's an has traits. So has traits will basically get every argument you pass to constructor or to the class itself, and it will call its init, which will set all the traits. Okay? Anything is allowed, it's Python, right? So you can. Yes, so anything you call here will be sent as a property automatically. So even if it's not a trait, so it's a cheat there, it's an abuse of traits. Because, see, if you set new attributes here, I mean, people will be looking at you, where is this? But the nice thing about traits is everything is documented here. I look at the traits class, I can tell you, hey, this has an initial state, it has this, it has this, it has this. When this changes, this happens, and that changes. So it, when you look at the code, visually it is obvious when you read it. Right? Clear? Any questions? Yes.
Sometimes you might pass arguments that are not traits.
Yes.
You have to worry about overriding aspects of it.
Yes. You may have to worry about that. Supposing you have a situation where setting this depends on this quantity being set. Then you have kind of pause, right? Because back then you have said that, and then you are listening for some change, you are saying on ODE change solve something. But the initial state is not set, you can't change. So then you can override init and say no, every time ODE is passed, that solver is set first. You could do things like that. It's Python. Right? So do what is best in the least amount of code, there's one obvious way to do. So now let's build a UI for the solver. The UI will simply be view again. Item ODE, so I want to see the ODE parameters. I want to see the initial state, and I want to see the solution. But the solution is read-only, right? I can't change the solution. And it's a property with only a getter. Look at the previous slide. There is no set solution. Solution is computed from this process. So the user can't go and say solver.solution is equal to 123. You can't do that. It's denied. If you do it, it will give me an error. So that's the view. Okay? Now, let's take a look at this code really quickly. Running short of time. So, this is the code. Okay? I've just done some little bit of cheating. I've decorated this array to call it some float type. I'm saying some calls is 3 so that I get a nice pretty clean UI. Okay? But the rest of the code is essentially the same, right? You all agree with me? And here is my main. So if I call this, it should give me a solution, okay? I call this, and I got a solution. That's the solution at the time that I have requested. Make sense? That's the basic. So ODE2 simply has the same code, and all I've added is this view. Remember, I created the basic class, I used it, solved the solution. Now I just throw a view to it. Now let's see what it looks like. And in the bottom is the print solver.solution and then solver.config.traits. Right? So here we have a UI that's built out of whatever you have written in the code. Now if I change the initial state, say, to 1.1, notice that it changes. Right? But if I do this stuff, the parameters I update, nothing changes. Why? Because just because the ODE is some parameter, the ODE is changing. My solve function is not called again. Why? Because the dependency that I have set up is only based on changes to the ODE itself. Okay. I have to now basically say, if something inside that ODE changes, update yourself. Okay. So one way of doing that is, I could simply say ODE.r, ODE.s here. Another way which I would prefer is to say changed equals event on rate change. That I will change something. This can be anything. Yeah? That I will change. Self dot change equals true. Come here, just say change. So what have I done? This ODE, you know, so now it's localized, right? Every ODE that I have, each ODE will have different parameters. And the solver class doesn't have to know, oh, there's R, there's S, there's... Instead, the ODE simply has a change daemon. Whenever the parameters of that ODE, the ODE determines that has changed. Again, separation of concerns. The ODE is concerned about its parameters and its changes. The ODE solver is concerned, okay, ODE has changed. ODE is changed, daemon was fired. That's all. Again, separation of concerns, so the model is very clear. So now let's run this. Tell me what has changed, no? What trade changes are S and D. Okay. So I'm basically saying if I changed R, S or D, tell it to update. Okay? Is that clear? So, yes. So this decorator does that to me. It's decorating this function. So if any of these are called or changed, this is the callback. Ah, okay. So this fires a change daemon, right? The property here depends on ODE logic. So this guy automatically wires everything up. So that's again another thing. Two lines of code, you know exactly, and I know exactly what I mean. I say property, property is ODE dot change, I'm done. So here, get solution. Property simply returns self-concept. Well, you can create any number of properties. I could create one property, solve solution, something else called something else, I don't know what else. Right? You can create any number of properties. Each of those properties can define a dependency between anything else on that class or inside some other class that it contains. Like ODE change. This is an attribute inside ODE, right? So it tracks that. If that changes, it will update. Is this clear? But it's very clear, right? There are just two places. I don't have to do some fancy call this back, on this thing happened, do this. I just fire an event, change this, and I'm done. So in this case, I just use an event trait, which is again a default trait that's available. I use the on break change decorator and I change the dependency using the depends on with the extended break, like an ODE not change. So that plot wasn't very fancy, right? It's just the values. So it turns out Charco allows us to create plots and embed them inside trades as well. So you can do this for any WSO3D application. It's fast and interactive and it interfaces very well with trades. You can build really sophisticated plots, kind of like, I don't know, it's good on my screen. So this is this basically is an inspector. Click on a point here or just move your mouse, it will tell you where it is and show you the this slice and that slice. A variety of plots can be created with Java. Yes? This is an idea, these are isochronous, yes. Yes, just 2D, but a variety of 2D plots.
So what's happening over there is...
Yeah, so this one is just one graph. There's like a matplotlib, you can create multiple plots. Just creating multiple plots. And you're moving up events. So as I move the mouse here, it'll show a cursor there. And take a slice of the data, and then plot that here, or plot that there. So you can build very sophisticated interactive plots with Charco. But I'm not going there. I'm going to solve our problem. So again, I will create ODE not to be as straight. I will create a distance of ODE smaller. So I am separating the problem from the solution. I'd rather not ruin my solver code. I create an instance of component, which is basically imported from variables API component and component editor. I create a plot data, which encapsulates the data that I want to plot. There's a little detail here that I'm skimming. And then I create a view which says, give me a solver, show me the plot, and give me the array component that I want to plot it to. 2D image, I will pick. I have three variables, x, y, z. I have time. So I should be able to choose which one to plot, x or y or z versus t, right? To see the solution. And then I set it up so that the plot updates. So I create a default plot, okay, which basically constructs a plot, plots t versus whatever I've asked. And whenever the solver solution changes, or the array component changes, it will update this. Okay? I'll give the slides later on, you can take a look at it. But let's run this. So here's the plot, here's the solution. As I do this, it automatically sets it up so that I can change it. Change the initial condition. I could change the array component. And everything is hooked up to me automatically. Okay? I have 1 minute. Okay? So it's not a lot of code. So in 110 lines, I have the solution, I have the UI, I have 2D plots, and I have 3D plots, which I'll get to show you. So with MongoDB, you can do something very similar. Again, I can create a 3D plot. I create a bunch of traits. I create a view. Okay? And I set up the hooks. So right, when the solver solution changes, it generates the plot. That's all. And now I get something that looks like that. Let's look at the code. This is the plot in 3D. This is the entire code. I'm not cutting down anything here. I'll just comment this out. So 110 lines, I gave you 2D plots, I created an object that can solve a nice problem. I can do 3D plots, I can embed them, I have customized graphics where I can draw stuff, and with that, just that much code. So now you know why I didn't write MongoDB with anything else. I didn't write it in TK, in QT and things. I chose this. Done? Since I handled questions, can I just take 1 more second? I just finished with one thing. So now we build an object model, right, with views. Now if I have multiple different applications, I can put them together using NVSTITCH. And the way NVSTITCH basically works is, you have the application, you have plugins, you create services, and you basically hook everything up in a very clean way without touching your object model too much. So it sort of makes it very easy for you to construct very complex, rich applications like my application itself with very minimal amount of code, with a very clean object model. That's kind of based on the technologies that you use. Thank you.